When it comes to preserving fossils, we know that the ideal way to keep them safe is to cover them with new sediment, really, really gently. Like packing up your glassware when you move. You want to be careful and put down lots of cushiony layers to keep everything protected. And you know what that doesn't make me think of? Volcanoes. But it turns out in the right circumstances, volcanic activity can actually be the key to preserving some incredible fossils. So here are a few times that cataclysmic volcanoes managed to preserve picture-perfect fossils. We'll start off at one of the most incredible fossil sites in North America, the Ashfall Fossil Beds in Nebraska. The site is about 12 million years old, and excavations here have uncovered hundreds of fossil skeletons of rhinos, camels, tortoises, and other animals, all preserved in a massive deposit of volcanic ash. And funny enough, that volcanic ash wasn't even from anywhere in Nebraska. It came from a volcanic eruption 1,600 kilometers away in what's now Idaho. It's called the Bruno Jarbidge Eruption Center, and it's part of the same volcanic system as the supervolcano that's underneath Yellowstone today. When this volcano erupted around 12 million years ago, it spewed out a ton of ash that was then blown all across the continent, all the way to a thriving waterhole full of animals just minding their own business until that ash began to fall from the sky. The ash was falling. Ashfall fossil beds. Huh? Anyway, this ash didn't just bury the animals. The ash is what killed them. See, volcanic ash isn't like a little snow flurry. The particles are fine enough that animals can easily end up breathing the ash into their lungs, and that's about as bad as it sounds. Many of the fossilized bones have these kind of frothy-looking growths that are associated with respiratory issues. So these fossils show us that the animals died as a consequence of breathing in all this toxic gunk. We can even tell what order the animals died in just by looking at the layers. The lower down they are in the ash layers, the earlier they died. Small animals like birds and turtles are buried deepest, meaning they died first as ash continued to fall. Then we start finding medium-sized animals like the ancestors of modern horses and camels, which survived for longer because of their larger lung capacity. And finally, at the top of the deposit are the site's biggest animals, the rhinos. And yes, there were rhinos and camels living in North America back in the day. More than 100 rhino skeletons have been found at Ashfall. Although the ash was deadly to living animals, it provided a nice soft bed for their remains, allowing their fossils to be preserved in truly stunning detail. Some skeletons are preserved in three dimensions, exactly as they'd have been when the animals were alive. And we even have impressions of some of the birds' feathers in the ashes. So this 12 million year old natural disaster is now an incredible resource for scientists studying ancient ecosystems in North America. Volcanic ash can be great for preserving bodies, but it's also awesome at preserving other stuff, like footprints. In fact, some of the most famous fossil footprints in the world only exist thanks to volcanic ash. We're talking about the Laetoli footprints, which were discovered in Tanzania in the 1970s. Paleontologists have found thousands of footprints at Laetoli, preserved in 3.6 million year old ash deposits. These tracks were left by a variety of animals, including elephants, giraffes, birds, and even some insects. But by far the most famous feature of the Laetoli ash beds are footprints that look a lot like yours and mine. Amid the many animal footprints at Laetoli, researchers discovered about 70 footprints left by human ancestors. The footprints were most likely made by Australopithecus afarensis, which is the same species as the famous Ethiopian fossil called Lucy. And the footprints aren't just from one individual. We've got footprints from at least three of these guys. Two of the trackways are side by side, and a third individual followed. And what's funny is that the third one stepped directly into the larger footprints that were already there. But we have no way to know why they did that. To be clear, it's impossible to know whether these three were walking as a group or just all walked in the same place at similar times. But we can learn a lot about how they walked. See, at the time these footprints were found, we weren't all that sure whether our earlier ancestors were walking upright on two legs or using their knuckles for support, like chimpanzees. So finding a bunch of footprints with no knuckle prints really was a smoking gun and helped answer a fundamental question in human origins research. The Laetoli footprints Footprint site is like a layer cake of preserved trackways. The Sadiman volcano, which is located about 20 kilometers away from the site of the footprints, had a habit of belching ash in bursts around this time. An eruption would blanket the area in ash, and later rainfall would turn that ash into a sticky, cement-like mud. Our ancestors, along with other animals, walked across that mud and left behind footprints that were quite literally set in stone as the ash hardened. Then the next eruption laid down more ash that covered and protected those footprints. Millions of years later, erosion exposed the footprint layers, and the rest is history. These ash beds are a treasure trove of ancient information. But unlike other types of rocks, these are really delicate. Anything from rain, plant roots, or even the stomping feet of modern animals runs the risk of damaging these fragile pieces of history. So when researchers aren't actively studying the footprints, they cover them with layers of soil and sand for extra protection. So at least in this case, erosion giveth and erosion taketh away. Now, we've talked about what happens when volcanic ash reaches areas pretty far away from an eruption, but now let's look at fossils that formed a little closer to volcanic ground zero. When you're closer to an eruption, you're in danger of more than just falling ash. You've got to worry about things like pyroclastic flows. A pyroclastic flow is essentially an avalanche of superheated ash, gas, and rock that cascades down the slope of a volcano. These flows can reach temperatures over 800 degrees Celsius, and they move fast, meaning you really don't want to find yourself in the way of one. And you'd think a pyroclastic flow would just destroy everything in its path, and you'd be right most of the time. But on some rare occasions, it can also preserve really cool fossils. When they cool down, these pyroclastic flows form deposits called ignimbrites, which are kind of like pumice stone. One extraordinary ignimbrite deposit comes from Rome, where scientists CT scanned rocks from a 29,000-year-old ignimbrite and found something unexpected. Staring back at them from the scan was a vulture's head. Or rather, the space where a vulture's head had been. That pyroclastic flow had enveloped the vulture, and even though the actual bird has long since decayed away, the ignimbrite ended up preserving a perfect impression of its head. And this impression is stunningly detailed. It preserved the shape of the bird's tongue and eyeballs, and even an impression of its transparent third eyelid. And if this sort of pyroclastic preservation sounds a little familiar, it might be because it's similar to what happened at Pompeii. But this vulture head is preserved with way more detail than anything we found at Pompeii, and that might be because the pyroclastic flow that hit this vulture wasn't as hot as a typical flow would be. Scientists estimated that this pyroclastic flow had cooled to under 100 degrees Celsius by the time it buried our little vulture friend. And while I wouldn't exactly call near boiling temperatures cold, that ash flow wasn't hot enough to burn everything on contact, so soft tissues were able to be preserved within the ash.
Stop the video! We have an important announcement from the president! The president of science has decided to make this SciShow video free for anyone in the universe to watch. That's right! If any life form on any planet gains access to our internet, they will have absolutely no financial restrictions to learn about our world here on SciShow. And that is thanks to our incredible patrons on Patreon, like the president of science, McLaren Stanley. All of our patrons help remove barriers to information, but the president has allocated vast resources, the likes of which are rarely seen on the Patreon, to support this cause. Thank you, McLaren Stanley, for helping us keep knowledge available online for free everywhere, and thank you to all of you who watch, share, and contribute to SciShow on Patreon when you feel that you are able. To become the next president of science, you can go to patreon.com/scishow. Over and out.
Now, fossils in ash and rocks are one thing, but surely there can't be any fossils preserved in lava, right? Any plant or animal remains caught in a lava flow would certainly be instantly destroyed. Well, let me introduce you to the Blue Lake Rhino. Blue Lake is located in the state of Washington, alongside cliffs of basalt rock formed from the cooled lava of ancient eruptions. And within those cliffs is an unusual cave. When people first found this tiny cave in the early 1900s, they noticed that there were some fossil rhino bones inside. And when they went back to study the bones, the researchers noticed something weird about the cave itself. It seemed suspiciously rhino-shaped. And it turns out that, yes, the cave is really an impression of a rhino's body, preserved thanks to flowing lava. Of course, something like this doesn't happen every day. The rock in this site is called pillow basalt, which forms when lava touches water and cools really quickly. Around 15 million years ago, lava flowed into the water, enveloped the rhino, and cooled into solid basalt. Eventually, the rhino's soft tissue rotted away, leaving behind a rhino-shaped hole. Fortunately for the rhino, researchers think that it was already dead when it became engulfed in lava, and might have just been bobbing in the water until that lava flow came along. And there are other log-shaped caves nearby, leading researchers to think that they were made when the lava hit trees floating on the water. In any case, this rhino's death cave is probably one of the coolest ways to be entombed, like, ever. Now, so far, we've seen body fossils preserved in ash and even lava, and we've seen footprints in ash. But now, get ready for dinosaur footprints preserved in magma. At the Jindong Formation in South Korea, there's a layer of igneous rock from the Cretaceous period that contains footprints belonging to sauropods. That's the brontosaurus type of dinosaur. And some of the footprints are up to 3 feet long. There are also some footprints preserved in ash here, too, but the magma footprints are the real prize. And yes, footprints in magma might sound strange for a couple different reasons. For one thing, animals can't walk across molten rock. They'd burn their little feetsies, or their big feetsies in this case. And the other problem is that I said magma, not lava. You might remember from geology lessons that lava is molten rock on the surface, and magma is molten rock underground. Because of these different environments, lava and magma form different types of solid rock formations when they cool. And, well, these dinosaur footprints are preserved in a sill, which is a horizontal band of igneous rock that forms from the underground flow of magma, meaning that these rocks formed underground. And no, we don't think these dinosaurs were spelunking in magma flows. So here's what we think happened based on the geology of the site. The animals walked across mud and left behind all their footprints, which then got covered up and filled in by fresher mud, quick enough to preserve a ton of detail. And with enough time, those muddy layers solidified into rock. The lower rock layer has the actual footprints in its upper surface, and the upper layer has the natural molds of those footprints sticking off the lower surface. And over time, magma seeped in between these mudstone layers and conformed around the casts of the footprints. The magma eventually cooled and hardened, preserving the shape of the original footprints on the upper surface of the sill. Eventually, the mudstone eroded away, but the sill was more resistant to erosion and stuck around, exposing these impossible magma footprints. Now, even though these are magma copies of the original footprints, they're preserved in immaculate detail, and we can even see details of the toes and claws of the dinosaur's feet. So, voila! Magma tracks. So these are just a few of the times where the destructive power of volcanoes has ended up saving stuff that would have otherwise been lost to time. Which is super exciting to researchers, even if it was kind of a bummer for the animals who had to go through it all. At least, except for that Blue Lake rhino, which was already dead.